50,000, and they didn't still include the community or the CBOs, community-based organization, or any person from the community they didn't involve. This 80,000, is it for a one family or is it for a polygamous family? Because there are people who have a husband and plus five wives or five children. What about these women whose husband have died? What was that 80,000 for? Was it for that man who has that land, who owns that land, or is it for everyone? That 80,000 is also for buying land.
The Kenyan government will only get a 2.5% mining royalty from Tiomen.
Why we refused the second thing was that all this money that they are going to make, billions and billions of money, why can't they give, and what will the community benefit out of that? What will Kenya benefit out of that? Because they said annually, Kenya will get 2.5% annually royalty. What is 2.5%, and yet they're getting billions and billions of money out of that place? Is this company going to bring benefit to Kenya, or is it going to bring crisis to Kenya? Are we trying to improve the poverty ratio, or are we trying to decrease it? Is this Tiomen bringing blessings to us, or is it bringing curses? From our seeing, we see that it's bringing curses to us, because people will get blind, rivers will dry, people will suffer.
Like the people of the Niger Delta, the people of Kwale know that their perilous situation is a result of Western neocolonialism.
We don't trust the government. It can be bribed. From colonial period, we have visited the colonial. But I think we're still there. Because of late, you're not even free. Because everything we have to do, maybe we have to go, we have to ask permission from these states. You know, we are not as independent as we think.
Nigeria and Kenya are only two amongst many African countries whose resources are being looted by Western multinational corporations. An important aspect of this thievery is tax looting, which is facilitated by a global infrastructure of corruption set up by Western governments and corporations in collusion with the World Bank and the IMF. This infrastructure includes many tax havens, banks, false transfer pricing by corporations, and the imposition of very low tax rates on African countries.
The result is that Western multinationals pay little tax to African governments and are able to extract a massive amount of capital from the continent. The African Union estimates that $148 billion leaves the continent illicitly every year. This money goes mainly to the US, Britain, and Switzerland. An astounding 30% of sub-Saharan Africa's GDP has been moved offshore. To expose this phenomenal looting, African and Western economists and activists set up the Tax Justice Network at the World Social Forum held in Nairobi, Kenya, in January 2007. Charles Abugre from Ghana spoke for the Tax Justice Network at the forum.
Africa is usually considered as an income-poor country, a capital-poor country. In reality, since 1995, Africa has been a net capital exporter to the developed world, and in massive quantities and values. This capital export is usually very simplistically referred to as monies looted by African governments and African elites to the north. The story is a lot more complex than that. Our estimates is that of all resources that flow out in net terms from Africa, the share of corruption in that outflow is less than 10%. Even the corrupt money do leave Africa because the environment and the mechanisms are in place that attract and suck out the money. Corruption per se is not a good thing, but it always be reinvested if it doesn't have a haven to go to. Tax havens, banking secrecy is the major mechanism that encourages the sucking out of money from Africa.
John Christensen is an economist and a director of the International Secretariat of the Tax Justice Network. He is a former economic advisor to the government of Jersey, a major tax haven which is part of Britain.
For every dollar of aid that the West gives to Africa, $10 of dirty money flows out from Africa, heading northwards into secret bank accounts and offshore companies. Over the last 50 years, a shadowy economy of tax havens and offshore finance centers has been created. These places are very secretive. At the moment, there are about 72, maybe 75 tax havens around the world. Some of them are very small islands, but some of them are major finance centers like the City of London, like Frankfurt, New York, Luxembourg, and other major centers like that. The vast majority of multinational corporations make extensive use of offshore companies in order to avoid paying tax in the jurisdictions where they make their profits. Chevron, Texaco, Shell, a whole host of extractive industry corporations have been involved in this. Those in the West, particularly the Western governments like the British government, the United States government, the World Bank, who point the fingers at Africans, really should begin by tackling their own poor governance and their own corruption. A starting point is to close off the secrecy space and this corruption interface of tax havens, which enable and facilitate and encourage corruption in Africa.
Many multinational companies combine the use of tax havens with corrupt trade pricing policies that also enable massive tax looting.
And they do this largely through transfer pricing techniques where they export their commodities out of Africa at very low prices and import into Europe and North America at high prices, leaving the profits in offshore jurisdictions where it's tax-free.
For example, there are some studies show that between 1996 and 2005 alone, the loss of money as a result of either low pricing of exports to the United States, only as an example, or high pricing of imports from the United States lost Africa in net terms over $31 billion. If you extrapolate that the United States is only has 40% of the total trade volumes of Africa, then we are talking about a minimum of $75, $80, to $100 billion that flow out in trade misinvoicing. That is transnational companies that are importing and overpricing, exporting and underpricing the exports that they give.
Along with tax havens and false pricing, a third tactic that enables corporate tax looting is the U.S.'s use of the World Bank to force African governments to reduce their taxes. This is known as tax competition.
And tax competition that forced African government to reduce taxes almost to zero, basically getting entirely nothing from the natural resources with their main source of revenue. And Zambia is a very ridiculous situation. In 2004, Zambia exported what they quote is not really what the real value of exports are. They quoted $1 billion of exports from the copper industry. They paid the Zambian government $8 million of total revenue. But the real value, if you then factor in this mispricing that I talk about, you will be thinking about between $2 to $3 billion. Entire revenue share of the mineral wealth to the Zambian people is $8 million out of a declared $1 billion. Now that is scandalous. Or this is about 0.6%. Now that means that all of the price booms in the commodity sector is not going to benefit Africa at all unless you address transnational companies basically ripping and ripping the continent of resources.
You have been listening to Corporate Plunder, the third episode of the documentary series The Ravaging of Africa.
The Ravaging of Africa is dedicated to the memory of Patrice Lumumba.
This series was written by Asad Ismi and produced by Kristen Schwartz. Go to www.asadismi.ws. That's www.asadismi.ws for more information or to download the series.
Translation by Maziar Mahajir at Toronto Conversation Corner and Farid Omar. Voiceover by Benedicta Madavo.
Theme music is Nerbalankina by Captain Yaba from Ghana.
On this episode, you also heard International Thief Thief by Fela Kuti from Nigeria. The series was funded by Canadian Union of Public Employees Local 3903, QP National, Canadian Union of Postal Workers National, CUBW North Bay Local, Canadian Labour Congress, Public Service Alliance of Canada, Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation, Ontario English Catholic Teachers Association, Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives, and Mining Watch Canada.
Thank you for listening.